today. So the talk, the topic today is like consumer culture in transition, the consumption habits and subjective mobility experiences of globally mobile millennials from China. So it's a long title. Okay, so I think basically today I'm just going to talk about how some young consumers in the emerging market, how they perceive their social mobility experiences and how this kind of perception will influence their shopping behavior. So this is what I'm going to talk about today. So why study consumers in social mobility? I will try to introduce this topic and then why this will be a like alternative, but probably a useful lens to understand consumers in the emerging markets. I will talk about the background context, so how and where I collected data, the research findings, conclusions. Of course, we'll have some time for the questions. So before we get started, I would like to talk a little bit about social class and consumer segmentation, because compared to social mobility, probably more people are familiar with using social class to understand consumer behavior, to predict consumer behavior. So I would like to briefly talk about why like social classes construct can be used in like predicting consumer behavior. Then we can talk about why there are some consumers they probably does not fit into this this category. Okay, so I would like to show you two TV commercials, and both are automobile TV commercials. The first one is from Ram Truck, and the other one is from Lexus. Okay, so the first, we just take a look at that first, and then I can explain like who they are targeting. So the first one is from Ram Truck, and then this commercial is like 90 seconds. So we can take a look.
Praise the mill, praise the rig, praise the rope and the pulp and the die. Praise the time card, the green card, the union card and the WIC card. Praise the single working mother, bright-eyed and bone-tired. Praise the coffee, praise the cup. Praise the daycare open late. Praise the dinner, now cold. Praise the cranes, reaching their giant hands up into a cloudless sky. Praise the lonely, laboring in the white linoleum glow of midnight halls. Praise the line worker and the line. Praise the foreman and the floor. Praise the second shift, early Saturday. Praise the candle lit at both ends. Praise the snow just as it begins to fall. Praise all who sacrifice time at home for the one day dream of their children's lives outside of it. Praise the workers. Praise the work.
So this one is like, I like it personally. Okay, let's take a look at the second one. So the second one's from Lexus, and it's only 30 seconds. Okay.
It's not just a car, it's your daily retreat. Innovative technology, refined styling, that feeling you can only find in a Lexus. Go ahead, spoil yourself. The ES and ES Hybrid. Experience amazing.
Okay. So, yeah, thank you. Thank you for turning on the light. So I think apparently we can tell that these two advertisements are targeting different consumers, right? If in terms of social class, I think it's clear one is more like targeting working class. By the way, the name of the TV commercial is called Praise the Work. The other one is called Some You Time. Okay, it's targeting probably more middle class and metropolitan consumers. So it's not just about the images that are represented in the TV commercial. I know like we see more blue collar images here, more like a white collar, and then more metropolitan images there. But it is also about something deeper, about social class that can be used in consumer studies. For example, scholars found that usually working class consumers, they will take a so-called referential reception position, which means when they are watching this cultural text, it can be TV commercial, it can be movies, they like to see the content to be more or less directly relevant to their everyday life. So they like to see their story and their image in the cultural text. But middle class consumers, they probably don't need that. Working class consumers, we believe they have a more local lifestyle. Middle class consumers, more cosmopolitan lifestyle. We can see the guy in the TV commercial, he was having sushi as a dinner, if that can be a symbol of being cosmopolitan. Working class consumers, they are believed to have a psychological disposition to be more interdependent. So which means if you want to convince them, you probably need to appeal to people, relationships, the connection to others. So talk a lot about their social roles, like as a father, as a husband, as a friend, as a colleague, for example. And then middle class consumers, they probably want to stand out, and then they want to be independent, and they want to be able to differentiate themselves from others. So that's why the advertising message is more like indulge yourself in this amazing experience, and it's more like a private and luxurious space that you enjoy by yourself. Okay. So this is just one example about how social class is used in consumer studies, and this may be another one. So like companies like AC Nielsen, and then if you give some like information about the basic demographic variables of your consumers, of your targets, then they can easily say for like income, upper middle class income, age 25 to 44, employment, professional, education level, it's like college graduates. So that's the demographic variable of this group of consumers called up and comers. Then we can predict their media usage and consumer behavior, like they probably will order from Priceline.com, and then in terms of travel, they probably would like to go to somewhere in South America or something. Okay, so you know where, how to allocate your advertising budgets. But the interesting and also tricky part is that I think for this kind of logic, it is based on an assumption that when I use this demographic variables to define you as either up and comers or working class, so I think you are working class. I design this persuasive message, I deliver it to you, and I expect you to read and respond to the message in a certain way because you should also see yourself as working class so that you will respond to the message in an anticipated way. I think that this is true in many cases, but I think there are also some cases like probably consumer self-identity will not be completely consistent with how they are defined on paper, right? For example, in societal shifts, we probably can see some consumers, they're experiencing social mobility, and they probably does not fit into a certain social class construct. So I just would like you to read the title. It's like the young and the upwardly mobile, which is a very common way we use to describe the consumers in the emerging markets. So we think probably they have a different job from their parents, they have a different lifestyle, they probably live in the city, they have a professional lifestyle. So they are like moving upwards, right? So how can we categorize these people based on some traditional or existing social class ideas? Or this can be an example about downward mobility. So again, just the title, a PhD with your coffee, barista serving your drink might be better educated than you are. So this news article is about the high unemployment rate in Europe, and then some European young people, they need to leave their home country to big cities like London and trying to get a job there, but usually they are underemployed. So for this kind of consumer, if I look at their background and their education, it's like pretty upper class. But in terms of their income and their current employment status, then it's hard to define. So I think that's how I get interested into consumers in social mobility, about their ambivalent identity. And then, so when we study consumer in social mobility, I know we have a lot of studies about social mobilities already. But when it comes to consumers, I think the point is more about how mobility is actually lived in our everyday context. So how people feel about their mobility experiences, how people interpret that, okay? So for example, there was a study about how people's subjective idea and subjective understanding of their social mobility can change their economic behavior. Like if they perceive high economic mobility, which means just like the American dream, So if you work hard, eventually you will be successful, like this kind of logic. So if that is possible and people believe that, they will be more motivated to regulate their financial behavior toward long-term success. So which means they probably will be more willing to save money and they will try not to do so much impulsive spending. And also there are studies about consumer in social mobility and their eating habits. So we can see like consumers experiencing upwards and downward mobility. Of course, they want to be more associated with the upper class peers and try to differentiate from the lower class peers. So they will create some discourses. Like they will say, I always read the ingredient label on the package before I buy something. Or they will say, I focus on nutrition and never eat junk food. Or they will say, we'll not buy some ready-made dinner. We'll always like prepare dinner from scratch, which means this kind of practice or this kind of so-called nutrition literacy will help them to differentiate different social classes. And I think that this will become more clear in social mobility studies. So as I said, I'm interested in knowing how the mobility trajectory will influence consumer behavior. So in the past few years, I interviewed consumers experiencing either downwards or upwards mobility. And then this project is about the upward mobility of consumers in the emerging markets. So at first, when I decided to do this project, I was thinking, so who should I talk to? Who will represent and exemplify this kind of upward mobility? So eventually, I decided to talk to international students. For several reasons. The first is because, as we know, like education is usually believed as a driver for upward mobility. And the second is I interviewed self-funded international students. So I didn't interview any doctoral students who are on scholarship. So they are quite motivated, not just because they spend a lot of money. It is also because to some extent, when they choose to study abroad, they also need to abandon the Gaokao track, which means like they cannot be fully prepared for the entrance exam to the university in China. So they have to make this happen like in terms of their decision to study abroad. Okay? And we can also see this is actually a trend in the emerging markets. So I believe probably we all know that now the engine for international students' mobility in the world is in Asia. So in terms of the international student population, the number one source country is China, and the second one is India. So basically, like international students come from these two countries, and we can see a trend in the emerging markets about like parents want to send their children overseas. Okay. So just like in last year, just in 1 year, in China, there was 544,000 students study abroad. And then for them, like United States is the most popular destination. Okay? But if we take a look at the number in the States, okay, and then on the other hand, the number in the States, there was about 1 million international students in the States last academic year, and about one third of them come from China. So it's about 328,000. So if we narrow down the context a little bit and focus on where I collected the data, which is from University of Illinois, then we can see the University of Illinois ranked as number 5 in terms of the amount of international students it hosts. And then for on campus, there was about 45,000 students, like the total student enrollment, and among them, 12,000 are international students. So among the 12,000 international students, about half come from China. So about 5,000 international students from China are on campus. Okay. Yes.
You have, you know, looking at these universities, there are many private universities, and you're saying they're self-funded, 91% of them. Uh-huh. So it makes me wonder, if they can pay their fees at NYU or at USC,
Yes. They're
probably pretty high up
economically
anyway. So Yes. How much potential is there for them to go, you know, upward mobility?
Exactly. I'm going to address that later, actually. So that would be one reason to account for why they tend to use a non-traditional way to define their upward mobility. So I will talk about that. They didn't expect a significant income increase after they returned home. Thank you so much. So as I said, I collect data in,
Similar point, to add on the point. Why don't you choose some students from the rural field? They go internationally, or they go to Beijing or Tsinghua University, right? So there's a big variation of this type of example.
Right.
They can significantly perceive.
They're upward.
Yeah, they're upward mobile. So why? What's your rationale behind your choice of your example?
Mm-hmm.
I think it's similar.
Yes.
For that time, I was thinking, answering your question, actually at the beginning when I was in the States. One is because I was in that environment. Okay, so that would be one. So it would be easier for me to interview them. And the second is actually the informants I eventually interviewed was a little bit different from the initial expectation. So at first I was thinking I will interview some tuhao, which means they will have a lot of economic capital, they are the new money, and then they came here. So I was thinking probably it will be interesting to talk about their like different levels of capital. They will have a lot of economic capital and then come here for internationally recognized cultural capital, like the credential. So I was thinking if with this dynamics, that would be more interesting about because we usually believe upper class, they will have a consistent more cultural capital, more economic capital, more social capital. Lower class, they have a lower level in each kind of capital. I think if I can talk about this dynamics, that would be one way for me to justify their experiencing mobility. But it didn't turn out that way, yes. So it's about my first rationale about interviewing them.
So it's more about culture?
It's about it's also so. At first, I didn't have that assumption about how did you define your mobility? Actually, I'm going to get to that in my first finding about how they define their mobility experiences. Okay. So I collected data on campus in University of Illinois, but I want to make that clear that when people heard that I was collecting data on campus. Their first impression, their first response was not about how this campus was different from others. Their first impression was about so you are going to interview the so-called Great Gatsby generation. So Great Gatsby generation is a term that used in BBC News article. So it refers to the new money and the rich second generation. So when I told people that I'm interviewing some international students, and usually people will get really excited and say, so you are going to interview those Maserati owners, right? And I was like, no, actually it was not like that. But generally, people think that probably there are some international students, they are super rich and they can splurge on whatever they want, and then they can buy nice cars. So they are called the Great Gatsby generation. But I want to make that clear that I don't think my informants are the rich second generation, and they also do not see themselves as a rich second generation. Okay. So who did I actually interview? So I interviewed 27 first generation international students from China. They are first generation means their parents do not have any study abroad or training abroad experiences. And then the interesting fact is that they usually plan to go home. So after the 1 or 2 year study, they came here for undergraduate or master's degree. They are enrolled in one of the top five universities, top five host universities in the States. They're age 19 to 25. They come from urban areas in China. And then all of their funds come from their family support. So their parents do not just give them money. They also usually give them a credit card they can use on whatever they want to buy. The interesting thing is that when I interview them, because it's about their shopping, so I have to ask about their budgets. And they usually are clueless about how much money they actually spend every month. So I got different numbers, but roughly I can say, as we know, for tuition it's about $30,000 a year at least. But for living costs, a very rough estimate will be about $2,000 every month. Okay. And they come from upper middle class, upper middle family background. They believe they are experiencing a kind of upward mobility. And then eventually, it is definitely not the first time they came to the so-called Western culture, Western countries. They had the experiences of so-called pedagogical trips, which means they probably came to the States before for summer camps for like short-term exchange programs or for like some academic competition. Okay. So they had these experiences. So I interviewed them, and today I would like to talk about my research findings in three themes. So it's first is about how they interpret their mobility experiences. And the second is about how this kind of perception will influence their consumer behavior. And the third is about their luxury consumption. Okay. So this is something, like the first finding is actually also quite surprising to me, is that they didn't use a traditional way to define their upward mobility. So upward mobility is conventionally or traditionally defined by education, income, and occupation. Okay. But we can see like one of my informants, April, said like she does not see her mobility track that way. So she said, I had a discussion with my parents before leaving China. We knew that based on price performance ratio calculation, going abroad has no good value. It takes you maybe 7 or 8 years of work to compensate for the tuition for 1 year study. So the purpose of studying abroad is not about compensating for the cost, as we knew this is unlikely to happen. So I would not regret even if I don't have a good job or a high salary in the future. I came here for an experience, and I don't think I need to use this to exchange for anything. Actually, about 10 years ago in the early 2000s, there were some survey studies indicating that these returnees, usually they still have maybe unrealistic and very optimistic expectation about their significant salary increase. So they think the salary will increase a lot. But after 10 years, actually, the data was collected last year in 2016. So at least among my informants, I didn't see this trend. I didn't see like they expect to have a promising future or a significant salary increase after they go home. Okay. So I think now their expectation has been different. But if this is true, then why do they still come to the States? I think I found that the way they understand their upward mobility is quite overlapped with geographically outbound mobility. So they would define their mobility experiences, for example, because of their vision or because of their experiences, because they are more informed consumers of different cultures. So like Elaine said, the mobility experience is that I'm moving up or moving out. I study abroad, which means I have seen more because of the geographical relocation. I started to think of things that I have never thought of before. I have new perspectives. Maybe my parents do not have such understanding due to the lack of cultural impact or some opportunities. I think I have been upgraded to a higher level of thinking. This is what I mean by moving up. Another similar quote from Gabriel. So he said, I have been thinking that I'm lucky. I'm jumping upwards, like using a springboard from the interior of China to Shenzhen to Macau and to the US. So the validity of the springboard theory aside, I believe my vision has expanded. My capabilities are sharpened, including overcoming the challenges I encountered. I have seen more. Comparing to my old classmates, I think we have different attitudes and visions. Okay. So we can see like how this is how they define their mobility if we can look at the right-hand side column. So they usually talk about and emphasize their vision. So they say they are keeping up with the world and then their experiences. And they also say that they are able to do critical thinking. They are independent. Yes.
Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off. So just the construct mobility, I'm having a hard time appreciating whether that's really what's going on here. So you have this sample of students who have gone abroad to study,
right,
and they feel that they're getting an experience that perhaps doesn't have any monetary value attached to it. It's a life experience. If I were to backpack around Europe for 2 months, I might say very similar things to what these kids are saying. You know, it's not an investment in terms of upward social mobility in an economic sense. It's an investment in experience in life and you know, whatever value that has is somewhat intangible. So I'm having a hard time mapping on the choice of kids studying abroad who feel like they're transforming their lives in this experiential kind of way with the construct of social mobility.
Yeah, thank you for the question first. So I was thinking of that probably is like a justification, because they came here already, so they would justify that, okay, so this is how I define mobility. But I think there are also a few other perspectives. Like, first, I think they are quite determined to do this, and then they also pay a lot of money, and also, as I said, they abandon the Gaokao track for this. And also, I think this is also based on self-report. So in the entrance exam in China, yes. Okay. So they kind of like cannot fully prepare for that, so they kind of make this choice. And also, I will talk a little bit about how they still believe in the potential HKUST traditional. They still believe in upward mobility in the traditional sense, but just in a different way. So they will prioritize this outbound mobility and say, I understand this as upward mobility, but they also subscribe to the traditional constructs of upward mobility as well. And also, I think that this is also because based on their self-report. So in the screening process, I talked to them, and they believe this is a kind of upward mobility. So I hope this will be clearer when I explain why they probably employ this alternative definition. So there are probably several reasons to explain why they tend to use this way to say this is an upward mobility instead of using a traditional variable like income or career. Yeah. Okay. So I think because of my informants using this variable to define their mobility experiences, and I actually compare this with some other studies. So previous studies indicated that individuals, they will use some novel and alternative framework to understand their mobility experiences when the traditional mobility possibilities are not an option, are not a feasible option in their current context. For example, like in 2011, there was a study about Moroccan women living in Netherlands. So they are immigrants. So it's more like a horizontal mobility, actually. But they define that as an upward mobility. So they would say something like, for example, I have access to informal education. They don't have access to formal education, but they would talk about informal education. They would say, I teach myself Dutch, or they would say they visit museums regularly. So they would talk about this kind of practice and define that as a kind of upward mobility. But I think the interesting part is that this like orange line in the bottom is that they didn't completely abandon the traditional way to define upward mobility. So for these Moroccan women, they will use a new and a novel and alternative framework for themselves. But when it comes to their children, the next generation, they will once again use a traditional way to define upward mobility and say, you need to go to good universities and you need to get a diploma and then to get a good job so that you can get ahead or moving up. And for my informants, they also talk a little bit about this traditional upward mobility thing. But they talk about that in a delayed, uncertain, and potential form. So which means they would probably say, when I go back to China, I didn't expect that I will earn much more compared to my Chinese peers. But I think it's about a long-term competition, so probably after 20 years. So when my local peers, they have got the best in their career, maybe, and then I still have some potential for growth. Yes.
Do you have a sense of, you know, for your informants, what proportion of them are being paid for by their parents? Because it's possible that the parents want this upward mobility and the parents have the 20-year view, and the children are just saying stuff.
Yes. The interesting thing, I probably should say that in this slide, is actually they are the person who initiate the study abroad decisions. So usually I didn't see like their parents push them to study abroad. That usually they ask for the support from their parents.
Right, and then the parents say, okay, I'm doing this, but only because with your American degree 20 years from now, you will be promoted faster than the local kid.
The parents do that because
That's the parents' logic. That's why the parents are sinking all the money into this. Exactly like the Moroccan parents.
Oh, I didn't differentiate whether they got this idea from their parents or they have this idea about, like. But I do think that, I only think that they are more pessimistic about like their instant and their current context. They didn't like have an expectation like 10 years ago, like people would believe I have a significant income increase. So they at least didn't see that immediately. Thank you.
But they're all self-financed.
From their parents, yes.
No scholarships.
No scholarships. Yep.
Quick comment. Yes. I feel you may need to think more about the comparison, because the left column, I think, is that these women cannot get these diplomas and jobs. Mm-hmm. So they have this social creativity. In social characterization theory, they think they get some informal education is very good, right? Mm-hmm. So they are up more. But in the right column, it's totally different situation. Mm-hmm. The up part is something good, right? It's high status. So these students can get the Gaokao, can get this local university, definitely, right? Mm-hmm. So it is not social creativity, it's something related to higher status. So the comparison of these two, maybe you can think more about, you get what I mean, right? So it's not that they cannot achieve this Gaokao thing, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's more spontaneous? Like,
but these women cannot get these diplomas and jobs, then they comfort themselves by engaging in social creativity. So I feel it's a different situation here.
Right. Yes, I agree. Like they can probably have a chance to follow the traditional track if they want, but they are more spontaneous in terms of like they are actively pursuing this. Yes, thank you. So I sort of like...
Yes.
Actually, I have one question.
Yes.
I'm curious about your sampling strategy. How do you choose this one?
The respondents. So basically in qualitative study, I think there's one that's very common, it's called purposive sampling. So you just actively choose the respondent that you feel they will bring the most fruitful data. So that would be one technique. But the actual process is like I spread the recruiting messages. And then for people reply to my message, I didn't talk to all of them. So I would do a brief screening process, and then to make sure like you understand this, and then so I decided to talk to them.
Do you think the sample is representative as possible? Because actually, when I was in the United States, I talked with my Chinese peers. They are also self-financed undergraduate students at UCLA. Mm-hmm. And when I talked to them, they said we expect we can earn more money, because we study engineering, computer science in the United States, and they have strong motivation to get the H-1B, to stay in the United States, to earn more money. And they think that they need to earn more money to repay to their parents. Mm. Yes, so I think it's different.
I believe there are some other students, they would take a different perspective. But I think because in this kind of qualitative interview studies, the way we try to generalize it is probably not about to generalize it to the population. So we didn't try to do this theoretical generalizability. We didn't seek this. But when I talked to them, I was hoping to just trying to focus on some novel practice of a current theory. So I believe there are some other students, they probably have this idea. And I believe so, yeah. So also when I was doing the data analysis, it was not like, the 27 of them all say this, so this is a theme. So I didn't do it this way. So there was a coding process, yes. Oh, thank you, okay. So some possible explanations about why they use this kind of a way to define their mobility. So the first is probably because of the political and cultural discourses in China. So the political, like traditionally about the two class social stratification and social class. So probably we don't have like Western social class constructs about like the social stratification, like you are like a ladder and then you are moving up from one social position to another, okay. And also because of the cultural sensibilities. I found that among my informants, also this is mentioned in some other literature, is that probably in general we perceive the upper class in China as like the political elites. The lower class, like in the urban area, probably the immigrant workers. But the big chunk in the middle is like, they have different names, probably middle group, middle class, or middle income people. But just in general, people probably don't have a clear reference about like this vertical mobility. So I think that may be one way, one reason account for why they are employing this alternative perspective. And also, probably this is just about generational value shift. So like millennials, they probably just value variety, they just value experiences, or because of their family backgrounds. So as I said, they come from upper middle class family background, so their parents can be lawyers, professors, and doctors. So they probably think like in terms of intergenerational comparison, they do not expect they to actually do so much better than their parents. And also, my informants mentioned a lot about their capital loss. So it's not just about capital gain. They also said that they feel there are some capital loss that they cannot has to secure a very good job in the job market in both China and the US. So the US people, of course, complain about their non-citizen status. So they feel they cannot get a job because of that. They talk about language proficiency, their lack of language proficiency. They probably don't have a very supportive social networking. In China, they feel they have lost some social networking, like the guanxi. And also, they feel there are so many returnees, so they are probably undervalued. Okay. So I think this leads to the second theme that I would like to talk about is their shopping behavior. So of course, when you define like upward mobility and when you define upward mobility through outbound mobility, I think it's understandable that they want to show that they are cosmopolitan and global consumers. So there are some kinds of products that they do not seek cosmopolitan meanings with. So they were just buying in China, and they didn't try to show their cosmopolitan consumers with this kind of products. For example, Chinese food. Low involvement, generic, and non-durable consumer goods. So for this kind of products, they do not try to show that they are cosmopolitan consumers. But for the rest, I think they are trying to shop for global brands in the global marketplace, and then they try to show that they are appreciating and then consuming the progressive meanings of the global brands. So I think that will be more clear when I show the quotes. So Hannah said, like, the service here is different. You walk in, you look around by yourself, you deal with the salesperson only when you are ready to pay. In China, the salesperson will follow you. It is annoying. I think there may be some people like to be surrounded by salespeople. But customers in my age usually hate it. Some small size girl may not know this, but I am not slim. I used to need to say, I need a large one in the store. It is like they were forcing me to say it out loud. After I came out from the fitting room, they would say something like, see, your legs look thinner. Your waist is not that huge. I just want them to leave me alone. So what I see in this quote is that this is how they do boundary work. It's not just like, oh, I'm consuming this high fashion, and then probably my friends are consuming low fashion. So I didn't see these contracts. What I see is that they are trying to say, they are trying to attach their consumption to some progressive meanings, especially a more liberal attitude toward our body image in the Western culture. So I think that is a progressive meaning that they are consuming. Yes. I think it's more like, I sort of like which is the best way to describe the meaning they're consuming. Probably more, they feel like it's more advanced, it's more, can it be political correct, maybe? Yeah, so, yes. So, and then another quote talks about how they use this online media content. So when I was in China, I was not aware of copyright issues. So it was free to watch videos or listen to the music online. But here, gradually, I'm willing to subscribe to Netflix and Spotify. I pay some money every month to buy the channel. It requires expenditure, but I'm willing to spend the money, no matter how expensive it is. I'm willing to pay every month. So once again, usually we think like the class distinction is represented in like, oh, you watch like opera, like high cultural content, and I watch like a Hollywood movie, for example. It gets a high-low culture. But again, I think that they are consuming the same content, but just like the practice and the channels are different. So they are saying like they can probably focus on like their copyright issue and they support this kind of social causes. And then while I think they are cosmopolitan consumers, I think the interesting thing about my informants is that I feel they are trying to be cosmopolitan in the Chinese perspective. So which means when they shop in the global marketplace, they constantly refer to their Chinese context to make sure that what they are shopping and all this practice have been popular and recognized in their Chinese context. So they didn't try to be early adopters. They didn't try to be like trend leaders, and they didn't try to say, I'm using these products while people are like, while it is not distributed in local market. I think they refer a lot to, like for example, Chinese reviews, Chinese bloggers, and the deal, like newsletters circulated in the Chinese international students community. So a very efficient way for them to show like their attachment to Western culture in a very legitimate and popular way is that they will shop a lot of global brands that are overpriced in China. So these products, they are sold in China already, so people recognize that, but they will shop a lot because they can afford that with a cheaper price. I think that may be clear if we take a look at the quote. So April said, when it comes to down code, it must be Canada goods. It is cold here, and the quality is good. I learned about this brand in China. The brand became popular because of the Korean TV series. So I think it's interesting if you need a down code to survive the Midwestern winter, then probably you will ask for your local friends like what kind of products they use or something. But they will refer to their background context and then to say, I want to buy something that's popular in China as well. Or I asked Iris, so I said, what kind of car do you want to buy? And she said, of course a nice car. Like nice cars are cheaper here, Land Rovers, Mercedes, BMW. My dad loves cars and he had a BMW. So if I drive a nice car, I can earn face for him. So I think it's a like earning face for your parents is quite a like Eastern cultural value. And then also, once again, she didn't like really consult people in this context, and then she trying to say like she buys something because of like the past identity or like the preferences of like most like her friends in China or her family's China will make this choice. I think I will quickly compare their shopping experiences with that of some new middle class in our other emerging markets. And then I think there are, of course, some similarities and some differences. So I think the I average one, this one is quite similar. So they are anxious about not being noticed, so they want to stand out. But they also want to, they will not try to, they want to seek individuality with the mass and popular brands. So they will not use some like brands for small markets and then to show like they are unique. So they want to stand out, but they also want to fit in. And I think there is a, like ambivalent practice. For this part, I think it's quite similar. And for this like unconfident cosmopolitan, for this practice, I see some differences. So for unconfident cosmopolitan, it's like consumers in the emerging markets, they usually would think like they feel their local market is not very cosmopolitan. What is popular here for now probably has been popular in London like 2 years ago. Or they would say like, for example, the quality of like the same products, but the things distributed here are with a lower quality. So we can like imagine like for upper class people, if they want to follow the Western lifestyle to show their status, then something they would do is that they would just follow it in the orthodox and a script-like fashion. So what does this mean? So this means when they probably travel to the outlet in the States, for example, they will buy a lot of things and have the whole set in their living room or in their yard. So this was a study done in Turkey. And then the special thing is that usually we believe the upper class people, they should have a cultural taste that they can improvise or they can mix and match. So they would say, I will mix some Turkish culture with the American culture and eventually have this new practice. But eventually they will have just the whole set. But among my informants, I didn't see that much. So I think they are definitely West oriented, but they are also past oriented and they are also influenced by their Chinese identity. Okay. And then so once when they're trying to like imitate, when they're trying to have practiced some Western consumption, they will also refer to their Chinese community to make sure this is a popular and legitimate practice. Okay. So I think I will quickly go through the last theme I would like to talk about so we can finish on time. So the last theme actually I would like to talk about is their luxury consumption. And then, so I think this is a popular topic in academia as well as in the industry. So this is how, like, we believe the younger generation in the emerging markets they usually use luxury products for. I'm not going to challenge that. I'm just going to talk about three luxury consumption that emerged from my data collection. So the first one is so-called essential luxury. So essential luxury is something that they would like when it comes with functional value. So this is something they will splurge on and they will trade up. So I think it's interesting because usually when it comes to functional value, we will buy something as long as it fits our needs. But for my informants, when it comes to functional value, they feel then it is a necessity, then I can splurge on that, and they usually will choose the best option in their price range. So it's from, like, can be from down coat to what they eat and to their housing options, and for electronics, then they will really splurge on the luxuries, and they wanted the luxurious options. The second is called elite class hedonic luxury. So for this kind of luxury, I don't think they will buy it right now. So it's more like something on their wish list. So when I interview them, I think in this part, I heard the most sense of guilt and doubt. So they would delay this kind of luxury consumption, but they plan to buy it in the future. So one reason is because they refrain themselves from this kind of consumption because of the traditional roles. Like, they feel, I'm still using my parents' money, and then I'm also a student, so probably it's not appropriate for me to use that. And the second is because they will prioritize a hassle-free shopping. So basically, I think my informants do not like the idea of, like, saving up and then for something. So if they want something, actually they can save for maybe 3 months, which is not a too long period of time. But they would like, if I need to save up for that, they would rather just save it for later. And then they like to have something as an immediate reward. Some products that they will aspire for are like elite class automobile and designer fashion brands. Yes.
So these variables actually are dependent variables you're looking at, right? The consumer behaviors. You're talking about this perceived social mobility leading to these behaviors. Is that your story, right?
Yeah, it's more like leading to the part that I just talked about. It's more like east-west transition. So that part is about two identities. And this one is like just the themes, like it's just a kind of their consumption. So I think,
can you explain a little bit of the mechanism or the logic of this perceived mobility? Why this perceived mobility will lead to this sense of guilt and doubt? It's not your story, right? I'm sorry, I'm a little bit unclear about that. Yeah.
Oh, sorry, I didn't make that clear. So I think the way I try to talk about is like how they perceive mobility will lead to what I just talked about is more like East and West, their two identities. So on the one hand, they want to signal they are cosmopolitan, but on the other hand, they also try to refer a lot to their Chinese context.
Okay.
So it's all about that part, yeah. And I think it's just like the luxury consumption is like also something that they talk a lot. And then, so I think that's also a theme that I can talk about, yeah.
So both identity will lead to sense of guilt and doubt here, right?
Mm.
So that, yeah, that's a proximal mechanism linked to the perceived mobility, right? Perceived mobility lead to both identities, then lead to this sense of guilty and doubt. Then lead to is that your logic?
I'm afraid I didn't see it like so. I probably didn't think like it's because how they perceive mobility result in the sense of guilt and doubt. So it was not like that. So the way they perceive mobility leads to how they negotiate with their cosmopolitan and local identity. But for this part, I don't think it's directly relevant to that. It's probably relevant in terms of this kind of luxury, experiential luxury. So they like all these experiences, they stress outbound mobility. So they will talk about like experiential luxury is also something they will splurge on. But I think probably it cannot explain why they hold back in terms of this kind of luxury.
Then why you? I'm not sure I understand. Yeah, if this is a core phenomenon you are looking at, right, their behaviors, right? Mm-hmm. You want to explain this behavior from the lens of this perceived social mobility. Is that your...
Yes. Can't this just be part of their referencing the Chinese context? Because in China, this kind of consumption is now criticized, right? Mm-hmm. I'm not sure the timing here, but, a more general kind of comment I have is that it seems like, in terms of the perception of mobility, it seems like this group of subjects, they don't, their view of their future is that they're going to go back to China.
Yes.
It's not that they're going to stay in the United States and make a life.
Right.
Although, so that's a bit, that's a little surprising to me in that I would thought these are undergraduate students, right?
And master's students.
And master's students. Well, that could, that might be different, I don't know. But I thought there would be more who would be open to the idea of trying to graduate from a U.S. program, stay in the U.S., work. Not this, not that they would necessarily do that, but that, because in a way, if you, these habits of like just thinking about this in the context of the Chinese reference group, like, oh, this would be, set me, people in China would be impressed. That is projecting themselves, the peer group there is China.
Right.
Whereas if they had a view of their future, which like when my parents went to the U.S., right, they were first generation Asian immigrants, they were completely determined to stay in the U.S. So their identity was trying to fit in with the American peers, not trying to distinguish themselves in any way from their, right, that, and so they really actively, in some ways, probably suppressed the, the Korean, if it interfered with this other goal of trying to fit in better or become more American, or really understand what it means to be an American person, right? So, so when we talk about mobility in this context, part of this is also about the vision of your future, right?
Right.
And the future mobility.
Right.
Yes, I think it's about the way they define mobility is about their vision, but I think their vision is also confined by their perception of this mobility is like they already know probably it's unlikely for them to stay in the States. So given the non-citizen status or a lot of like difficulties for them to stay here. So I think that's why, I'm just saying like it's like the interplay of these variables, yeah. So I think it's not like they determined to not stay in the States, but they kind of know in this context it's hard for them to stay here, I think.
It's hard to stay in the US. Is that true?
I think for their non-citizen status, they complain about that. Or they would say, actually, I have a few quotes.
Well, students have citizenship. I mean, there are lots of Chinese who have made lives in the U.S. after going to school in the U.S., right? A lot of my friends, especially if they go there for graduate school. So it's, that's the normal path for a Chinese, not to have citizenship when they're undergraduates. It's to get a good education and get a job. And once you have the job, then you can get the green card and eventually the system. That's the normal path. So I don't know why they would, why have not having a citizenship at that point in their life should not be here, neither here nor there. That's not even the common scenario at all. For
but actually,
how they would want to stay.
In the last 1 or 2 years, actually, it's the peak of the number of the returnees in China. So it's like a lot of people come back to China, and then. But it's because
like if you look at, I mean, the one I know personally is Korean immigration to the U.S., right? Where the earlier immigrants, they all wanted to stay, obviously. They didn't want to go back. There wasn't much to go back to, right? And then now, any Koreans who go to the U.S. for anything, they're all going back. They're all planning to leave. So there's a transition over time in how these flows work, I think, depending on kind of the advancement of the home country. So to the extent that Chinese are going to the U.S. wanting to go back, it actually kind of reflects that China has really developed to a point where people actually perceive the opportunities are still probably greater.
Right.
Where I'm a foreign education back home gives me opportunities that is better than me being an outsider with the same education as everyone else here.
So, yeah, and the third form I would like to talk about is the experiential luxury that we probably already know Like this is also something that we splurge on. And then, so experiential luxury to some extent can be viewed as a kind of hedonic luxury, of course. But when it comes to like experiences, they of course, it's like making the most of their overseas stay, especially if they only plan to stay here for 1 or 2 years. So in this quote, this is actually the last quote in the talk. So there are tips online. Hannah said there are tips online about how to save money during travel. I never pay attention to them. So I bring some money to travel. I spend on whatever I want. For example, when I went to Orlando, I would visit every park, try every facility, eat delicious meals, no matter how expensive the restaurants are. But she talks about like the second part is about the hedonic luxury. So once I was upgraded to business class for free, I was thinking that in the future, when I earn money, I would definitely choose business class for a long-haul flight. So I don't do it now because hedonic pleasure is a very private thing. It is about your lust. It is not something to be proud of. So I think this differentiates like, basically they are more willing to spend money on this on these experiences. And I hope this will echo to how they define, how they emphasize their outbound mobility. Okay. So I think we're running out of time. Actually, this is just a diagram to summarize my findings about there are some products and some practice that are more influenced in their Chinese value and Chinese context, while others are more influenced by their US context. But I try to see that there are like a negotiation and then both contexts will contribute to their shopping experiences. Okay, I'll make a quick conclusion. And then, so I hope to connect their consumption to their mobility perceptions. And then it's not just about they have definitely more discretionary incomes, but also like how they understand and how they perceive their experiences. And I think probably there are also some insight about the intra-class status signaling. So if people don't have a very salient social class consciousness, then how would they try to signal their status and how they would try to use some variables to show that the distinction? And eventually, I think it's interesting to look at the consumer behavior in the emerging markets when they are away from home. So we have some studies about studies when they are at home. We feel like they probably would perform West-oriented consumption when they are at home. But when they are away from home and they are now given full access to the culture that they adored, they used to aspire for, then I think I saw more dynamics about referring back to their local context. So I think this dynamics may be interesting too. Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much. Yes.
Okay. We can take a few questions, maybe. Yeah, in the back.
You did these interviews. In any of them, did you see these people have problem maintaining certain identity? You know, they sort of go through the tension. Some of the work done by Bourdieu on mobility talks about the identity fracture. You know. So these people have, so they know that they are moving up, let's for example, but they have tension to keep that identity. So do you see that in any perceivable way in your interviews, or how they spend money, or do they experience, do they experience certain kind of dissonance when they buy certain things because that has tension with their identity, how they're trying to manage that?
Yes, I think so. So when they are having this Western practice, and probably also like Professor Park said, like because they plan to go back to China, so I think they're signaling like when they are trying to say I'm a cosmopolitan and a Western and like a global citizen consumers, I think they are also cherry picking this kind of Western practice, and that will only make sense in the Chinese context. So they didn't really try to just embrace and open up to all this Western practice. So I think they hold back a little bit. And then I probably didn't see this in other studies about like consumers in the emerging markets. Usually they talk more about how they, like in the global trickle down theory, talks more about how they want to imitate the Western practice. But I do see like more dynamics and more negotiations in these kind of dual identities. Yes, thank you.
I have one question about that. So I think you surveyed the respondents' family income, right? So are there any variations in their
Chinese income? Because some Chinese students, their families are super rich, and they say, okay, paying 2 million RMB tuitions is nothing for us. But so some families, they are really like middle-class families, they say, okay, it's actually a hard choice for their parents. If we send you to the United States, you better stay hard, get a good job in the United States.
Right.
So I'm kind of curious about
whether the
respondents you also are all from kind of rich families.
I was also wondering just about variation within the sample.
Yes.
You described most of the results as kind of characterizing the whole group.
I had a slide, I don't know if probably, so I just talk about that. So basically, they all try to differentiate themselves from the upper class. They just say it is also like not an easy decision for us. So that's the first thing they say. But they also say they know they are like the better off group. So they know that because they said probably also some of my classmates, they also want to go to study abroad, but they didn't come here. So that's why I said they're upper middle class, but it's like based on my definition. The term they use the most is about salaried class. So they just say they are a salary class. And I think it's interesting because they didn't say, they try to stress that they are still like employees. So they are getting the salary through their savings. But also because of consumption, I think it's also interesting because a few of them mentioned that their parents just sell an apartment to afford this tuition. So it's just like they have 2 to 3 apartments and just sell one. And it's of course not an easy decision, but also they have 3 apartments. So I think that's why I see them as like upper middle class. Yeah, it's not. They didn't spend the money lightheartedly. They try to stress that.
I think if dad drives a BMW, that you know, it's fairly indicative of what sort of family income they might be having.
But I thought the question was about variation. Mm-hmm. Are they all the same?
I think roughly yes.
Very similar.
Yeah, at least they. But I think it's also referred back to what I said is about the over-generalized social class consciousness. So they would not say they are lower class, of course not. They will also not say they're upper class because they try to distance from that. But in this big chunk, I think I asked them about it. Of course, some of their parents are still single income family, of course. But there are some, like they have already some luxurious products. But they will usually use like better off or like salary class describes that. I believe so, yeah. So they also agree with that. So they will also refer to, like I said, they are from urban area. So they will say, in Shanghai, this is nothing special, for example.
They will say that to refer back to the context.
Any other questions? If not, let's thank Wei-Fen.
Thank you so much. Thank you.